I set up a Wittig olefination. The Wittig olefination involves the reaction between carbonyl compounds, such as aldehydes or ketones, and phosphorus ylides to form carbon-carbon double bonds. The phosphorus ylides can be prepared from an alkyl halide and triphenyl phosphine, followed by the protonation with a suitable base, like buli or potassium terbutoxide. Then, nucleophilic addition leads to the formation of a betaine intermediate, which determines the stereoselectivity of the reaction. The cis betaine will lead to the Z alkene via an oxophosphatane intermediate, while the trans betaine will give the E alkene. In general terms, many factors determine the stereoselectivity of the reaction. However, as a rule of thumb, stabilized ylides tend to deliver E alkenes, while non-stabilized ylides are prone to give Z olefins. As noted in the chemist's cookbook, stabilized ylides, which have at least one strong electron withdrawing group to stabilize the formal negative charge on the carbon, give the E product. On the other hand, less stable ylides tend to give the Z product. There are many different ways to set up a Wittig olefination. Many experimental procedures involve a two-step sequence. The first reaction is carried out to generate the phosphonium salt, followed by the Wittig olefination via in situ formation of the ylide. However, my substrate was base sensitive and formation of the ylide requires the use of a strong base, so I decided to follow a three-step procedure instead, where the ylide was generated and isolated before being added to a solution of the aldehyde. To set up the reaction, I had the help of my assistant. Our first step was to prepare the triphenyl phosphonium salt. To this end, to a solution of the alkyl halide in acetonitrile, we added triphenyl phosphine, and the reaction mixture was stirred overnight at 80 C. Using a condenser instead of the traditional Dimroth condenser to save water. After completion, we evaporated the solvent using a rotary evaporator, and the resulting crude residue was triturated with diethyl ether to afford the crude product as a beige solid. Our next step was to prepare the ylide, so the previously synthesized triphenyl phosphonium salt was transferred into a round bottom flask and suspended in THF. After cooling the reaction mixture to 0C, the suspension was treated with potassium terbutoxide, and the resulting reaction mixture was stirred at room temperature for 2 hours. Upon completion, the mixture was first diluted with DCM, and then filtered through a short path of ylide to remove inorganic salts. The filtrate, containing the desired product, was dried under vacuum, and the resulting crude product was dissolved in the minimum amount of DCM. Ethyl acetate was then added slowly until the solution became turbid. The mixture was left standing at room temperature overnight. The following day, the obtained crystals were filtered and rinsed with additional ethyl acetate to afford the desired ylide as a white crystalline solid. Finally, our last step was the Wittig reaction. To a round bottom flask containing the aldehyde and a magnetic stir bar, we added DCM and switched on the stirring. Once the aldehyde was completely dissolved, we added a solution of the ylide in DCM. My assistant was setting up the reaction, and, being a bit nervous because I was recording from a very close distance, she accidentally spilled some of the reagent out of the flask. This shouldn't happen. But it was not a significant issue because we were using an excess of the ylide. Besides, this kind of accidents sometimes happen, and it's important to adapt and know how to act when facing unexpected situations. After cleaning up the mess, we allowed the reaction mixture to stir for 1 hour at room temperature. After 1 hour or so, TLC analysis indicated full consumption of the starting material, and the solvent was removed under vacuum. The resulting crude residue was triturated with ethyl acetate using a spatula until a white powder of triphenyl phosphine oxide precipitated. The powder was filtered out using a shot funnel. and the crude residue obtained after evaporation of the solvent was then purified by flash column chromatography. While it was not possible to get rid of all triphenylphosphine oxide by trituration, this additional step greatly facilitated the subsequent purification by flash column chromatography. How do you usually get rid of triphenylphosphine oxide? Let me know in the comments. Also, if you like the video, please like, subscribe, or leave me a comment down below. I'll see you in the next video. Bye!